We're in the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 1 through 10. If you don't have a Bible, we have some Bibles in that basket over there, but I know Sandy's going to try to get that up on the screen for us this morning. Before we start reading, though, I just kind of want to give a little bit of background context of what's going on in this particular story or letter. You know, they have different terminology for the different books in the Bible. In the New Testament, you have the Gospels, which are narrative in nature, meaning they tell a story. The Gospels tell the story of the miracles and the ministry of Jesus. The book of Acts is also narrative in its context, the way that it voices out the Gospel, but it's the narrative of the early church and how the disciples and the acts that they performed under the power of the Holy Spirit. But then you move into really what's called the epistles, and then specifically pastoral epistles. Epistle is another word for a letter. And so many of these men of God, Paul wrote the majority of the epistles. He wrote 13 of them. But you also have writers like Peter and John. And so 2 Timothy is a letter that was written by the Apostle Paul. And is the second letter. That's why it's called 2 Timothy. He wrote Timothy, 1 Timothy also. But in 2 Timothy, the context is that the Apostle Paul is in a prison. I don't know if you've ever been in prison before, if you've ever been detained for any reason, but I can assure you that if you have been detained for some reason in this room this morning, you weren't probably detained for the same reason that the Apostle Paul was. I've been detained, so don't think I'm preaching at you. I didn't come over here to step on your toes. I've been there. I've been locked up on more than one occasion. I wasn't, you know, always a preacher, all right? But what I will say is this. The Apostle Paul was in prison for preaching the gospel. He said, for this reason, I am in bonds. The gospel that I preach has put me in bonds. They call me an evildoer. A malefactor was the word that was used. It's the same word that was used of Barabbas, who hung on the cross next to Jesus, who they say was a murderer and an insurrectionist, meaning he was a revolter, and in the midst of his revolts caused all of this chaos. Anyway, the Apostle Paul is in a prison called the Mamertine Prison, and it was basically a pit that's in the city of Rome. If you go on a tour there, I've never been there, but I've read about it, you can go to this prison where the Apostle Paul was inside of this pit. It was damp, it was cold, and you know, we've preached 2 Timothy before, but that's why he asked at the end of the letter for Timothy to hurry up and make it there before winter, to bring the cloak, to bring the scrolls. Paul wanted to continue to study the word. He was cold. It was not a good place to be. He was awaiting his execution. He wasn't just going to be in prison for a little while and then be released like in the past. No, he was about to get his head cut off. Church tradition teaches us the Apostle Paul lost his head under the reign of Emperor Nero during the Roman Empire. So it's in the midst of this context that the Apostle Paul writes to young Timothy. Young Timothy is a pastor of a church. But he's been a student of the Apostle Paul's for a large portion of his ministry. He's been following Paul through the ministry, and Paul has appointed him as a pastor, and he's got a very influential position in the early part of the church. Amen. And Paul understands the importance and really the essence of the message is that you must endure. You must endure in the midst of trial. You must endure in the midst of affliction. I entitled this morning's message, Get Untangled. Now, you know, I didn't think about this until this morning, but the Apostle Paul is actually tangled up right now. He's tangled up because he actually talks about that the fact that he has chains on him, but at the same time, that he has chains, the gospel is unchained. Amen. You can't hold back the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. You can't put chains on the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the truth of the gospel is empowered by the Holy Spirit. And there's no walls that can restrain it. There's no chains that can contain it. Amen. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the power of God unto salvation. Yes. And whenever the ears of man hear it and it enters into the heart, transformation takes place and brings forth life. But it seems as though, you know, as I read the scriptures, and I've read the Bible on multiple occasions, the entire Bible and other parts of it many, many times, I've preached, preached a lot and learned a lot through the years. And one of the things that I feel as though I can say without a doubt is that in the New Testament, there's not many people next to Jesus, really. I mean, Jesus is the one who endured it all. Amen. I mean, you don't get better than that. I mean, naked, carrying a cross, thrashed 39, at least 39 lashes. But, you know, that was Roman rule. I'm not trying to get technical on you because we talk about 30. He only received 39 lashes because that was the Roman that was the Roman law. No, Paul received 39 lashes 5 different times because Paul was a Roman citizen. So they couldn't beat him more than 39 times. Jesus wasn't a Roman citizen. Jesus was a Jew. We don't know how many times Jesus was beat. But the point is this, is that he carried that cross up that hill. He carried it and he hung naked on that cross and he endured until the end. But when it comes after Jesus, no other man that I have read in the New Testament endured like the Apostle Paul. I mean, when you look at the things that he went through and the fact that he kept getting up and he kept moving forward and he was committed to doing what it was that God had called him to do. So men pale in comparison to a giant like him in the faith. Yet to the world, he undoubtedly looked like a fool. He undoubtedly looked like a weak fool to the rest of the world around him. And here he is in this prison, entangled in chains, and he writes the letter to young Timothy, who it seems, if you read enough of Paul's writings and the times that he mentions Timothy, is maybe I'm not trying to be mean to Timothy because, look, he got a whole lot more accomplished for the kingdom than I ever have or probably ever will. But, you know, it seems like maybe he might have been kind of like a mama's boy a little bit, like a little easy to get flustered in the heat of the battle because Paul's constantly having to encourage him and console him. Now, granted, once again, we live in America. And I'm just being honest with you. There was a time in my Christianity, it ain't that way now, thank God. For the most part, anyway. But there used to be a time in my Christianity that if I thought some people were laughing at me because of my faith, I'd get all flustered and no more. Lord, give me grace. I will tell you this, though. I got in a conversation with somebody at the Y on Friday morning, I guess, and I mentioned something about one of the reporters on Fox News, man. Oh, Lord, I probably don't want to say it because y'all probably like her. But that girl, Megyn Kelly, started getting on my nerves in a bad kind of way. But that's another story for another time. Well, I set this dude off, and he started talking language. Like, I ain't heard language like this since way before I gave my heart to Jesus. And, I mean, and he was, like, all into it. And, I mean, he was like, and I was like, dude, slow down, bro. I didn't even know what else to say. It caught me off guard so bad. I said, dude, I'm a preacher. You got to stop. Like, I don't want to hear what you're saying, you know? And then I started thinking this morning, what'd you tell me a preacher for? I mean, the Christian needs to be able to stand up in the midst of that and say, you know, whatever the case. But the point that I'm trying to make is that I'm not trying to beat up Timothy too bad because I know myself that there have been times whenever I have, you know, shrunk back a little bit. And Timothy was living in a time frame when it was a whole lot worse for the people of God than really what it is today. The point, you understand what I'm saying? But I am trying to say that the Apostle Paul was constantly having to give consolation and comfort to young Timothy and telling him that you have to endure in the midst of affliction. You can't give up, Timothy, because, see, it's not just your faith that's riding here. It's not just the fact that you have to reach the eternal weight of glory. It's not just the fact that you don't want your own soul to be destroyed, amen? But it's also that others, their faith and their walk with God are dependent upon you continuing on in the faith, continuing on in the race, even in the midst of affliction, even in the midst of trial and tribulation and the things that you're facing. You have to continue on, young Timothy. You can't get tangled up. That's why I entitled this morning's message, Get Untangled. You can't get entangled with the affairs of this world, but instead you have to persevere and endure and continue on. And so here we read in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. He says, Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. So first off, I just want to point out to you that Paul is writing to a preacher. And he's writing to him specifically regarding his ministry. But don't you in the audience sit back and get comfortable and think, oh, he's talking to preachers this morning, because the reality of it is that this is for each and every one of us. I'm talking about true Christianity this morning. And I ain't here to pick on nobody else's church, but you can drive up and down the road. There's a whole lot of other churches, but I'm just going to be straight with you. In the modern church and what we see, the majority of what we see on television, we are not living true Christianity. People aren't preaching the truth of the gospel. It's not affecting their lives in such a way that it convicts them to live their life for the Lord, convicts them to be concerned about the souls of other human beings, convicts them to the point that they feel as though they have a duty and an obligation to their master who died on the cross for them and set them free from sin to let other people know that there's a real Jesus that loves them. And if you and I don't get a revelation of that and aren't willing to tell people about it, who's going to do it? Amen? And so he's preaching to a preacher, but at the same time, he's preaching to each and every one of us as Christians, amen, that are in the faith. And this is what he says. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, don't worry, we're going to break this down. You'll understand it when we're done. Yet is he not crowned. Now that word crowned right there is in the Greek language, that word crowned, we're just going to do a little bit of teaching real quick as we go through, is known as the Stephanos. Anybody that's been here for any length of time knows that one of the first messages I preached when we started was on the Stephanos, which is another word for the victor's crown. You ever seen in the games when the old, if you watched an old movie, how they would, if they in the Olympics, they would have, or you know, the original games, they would have that little ivy looking leaf thing around their head? That's what was called the Stephanos, the victor's crown. When you won the competition, then you got the crown around your head. And so the Apostle Paul says, a man also that strives for masteries, he doesn't receive the Stephanos, except he strives lawfully. The husbandman. Now, y'all know what a husbandman is, right? Because I taught y'all that a couple of weeks ago. But a husbandman is another name for a farmer. All right? And it's the idea of husbandry, which means it's old. I know it's an old King James language. I'm not going to go through the whole process again while I use the King James Bible. If you want to know, then watch a lamp in the dark, but that's why I use it. But the word husbandry is the description of a cultivation, either the cultivation of a crop, the taking care of a herd. It has to do with the concept of farming. The husbandman, the farmer that labors, must be first partaker of the fruits. In other words, the person who works the field, he eats the fruits that comes forth. He's concerned about the harvest. Amen? Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Now, what does that mean, the seed of David? Many of you who've been here for some length of time know, but for those that maybe haven't been around a while, what I need you to know real quick is this, is that starting way back in the Old Testament, God began to methodically and progressively reveal who the Messiah was going to be. Don't let somebody out there on the street that doesn't really know their left hand from their right tell you that the gospel isn't real, that Jesus isn't real, that this is all a fable. God's been writing this book for thousands of years of human history, and from the beginning, he began to lay out a detailed plan about who Messiah, which is the Hebrew word for the anointed one, Christ, the Greek word for the anointed one, was going to be. He told us he'd be the seed of the woman in the garden. He told us he would be the seed of Abraham. Then he told us that he'd be born of a virgin. He told us he'd come from the seed of David. He told us before that he'd come from the seed of Judah, which was a tribe of Israel from which David came. Then we're told he would come from the seed of David. Mary and Joseph both were descendants of David thousands of years later. What I'm here to tell you is that Jesus is the one that the Jewish people were waiting for. They had been waiting thousands of years for him to show up, and the Apostle Paul says he's of the seed of David. This is the gospel that we preach. We we've been waiting on it for thousands of years. Humanity's been waiting on it for thousands of years because they've been in the midst of darkness. They've been wandering around aimlessly in this little short vapor that we call life, looking for something to fulfill them, looking for something to bring them pleasure and happiness, and everything falls short and they just keep on being left empty. You can't get enough education to fulfill yourself. You can't receive enough power, a good enough job, a big enough bank account, a pretty enough or handsome enough spouse, cool enough kids that accomplish things in life. None of that stuff's going to bring ultimate a better car, a better house, a nicer suit, better clothes, better smelling cologne. And none of that stuff's going to work. It's going to make you happy and thrill you for a moment in time. But the reality of it is that when the freshness wears off, baby, if you ain't got Jesus in your heart, you're still on a search, on a quest, looking for a treasure that's hidden in the earth of this world. And that treasure is known as the Christ, the Messiah, the one that God promised would come to the people of Israel. And Paul's saying his name is Jesus. He comes from the seed of David. God told us he was coming. Hallelujah. And he came. And in my gospel, I preach that he resurrected from the dead. And the way that I know that he resurrected from the dead is because he's alive today. He's alive and well. He lives in my heart. I talk to him every day. I have a relationship with him. Hallelujah. And he's been leading and guiding me. And even though I've been whipped by the Jews 5 times, even though I've been beaten with rods 3 times, even though I've been stoned and left for dead, shipwrecked and left in the ocean, snake bit and time and left in nakedness and cold and peril and hunger, he gives me strength. He imparts grace to my inner man. Even though I sit here chained in the midst of this Mamertine prison, I found enough time. Give me a quill. Give me some papyrus. Let me write to young Timothy. I'm being moved upon by the Holy Spirit to tell you that he's real, that he's alive, and that he's living in the midst of my heart, and he wants to do a work in people's lives. Amen? And so here the Apostle Paul says that he's of the seed of David. He was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Look at this. Wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer. See, he told Timothy, endure hardness like a good soldier. Hardness, hardships. It's a verb, to endure. It's the process of enduring the hardness, the hardship. That same word right there, suffer trouble, same exact word in the Greek. Paul can write about it because Paul's living it. Nobody's living it like Paul. Timothy's over there just standing behind a pulpit, whatever it looked like when they preached then. Timothy, he gets the letter and he's like, listen, son, I need you to stand up. I need you to stand up, straighten up your back, wipe the tears from your eyes. I know life's hard sometimes, but come on, straighten up your back. And listen, you gotta preach the gospel. You gotta preach Jesus, the seed of David, the one that's alive. Yes. I know sometimes things are getting rough for you out there, but hey! Come on now, toughen up a little bit. I think my daddy would have liked the Apostle Paul. He says, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake. Now, you know, we've taught this word before. The elect in the Greek is eklektos. My chalk always breaks. Ek means out. Lektos is where we get our word for election. Which, when you elect someone, what do? You choose them. So the word literally means chosen out. Well, what were you chosen out of? You were chosen out of the world. Yes. Weren't you?
Yes.
When you were born your first time, you were born like your father Adam. Born into a sinful world, full of pain, full of misery. Born into a depravity, where you had a compulsion to go towards things that were contrary to the ways of God. And you didn't even know it, man. You thought you were having fun. And I can remember some of the stupidest things. I mean, I can't even tell you, because you just really think I was a fool if I told you some of the things I did when I was high and drunk and wasted. I mean, I just thought I was so cool and I was a fool. Sometimes I still act like a fool, but I was really an idiot then. And I mean, just whatever. I thought that it was like, I don't know, I listened to AC/DC or something and like, rock on, dude. Like, you know, these stupid movies and crushing beer cans on my head and stupid stuff like this. And thinking that was cool.
Yes.
Thinking that that was something to attain to. Anything to get a laugh out of somebody. Anything but hallelujah.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus, that somebody told me the gospel.
Amen.
Thank God for my big sister Debbie. I don't know if she still tells people about Jesus like she used to. I hope you watch the video because you need to be telling people about Jesus. I don't know if she still does or not, but back then, dude, she would tell you about Jesus at the drop of a hat. And it didn't matter whether you liked it or not. She had the truth. It was in her heart. It was coming out of her mouth. And you were going to hear about it, buddy. You were going to hear a whole lot about Jesus. If you rode in the car with her for any length of time, you weren't going to leave the same way. You were either going to hate her or you were going to love her because you were going to hear about Jesus. I thank God that my sister told me about Jesus because one day at 19 years old, hallelujah, I left my first birth in Adam and I received my new birth in Christ. And I was translated out of the world into the kingdom of his glorious Son, the Eklektos. Paul says, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, for the chosen out ones. Are you a chosen out one this morning?
Yeah.
If you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, hallelujah, and you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of God, what does that mean? The Holy Ghost moved into your heart.
Mm-hmm.
If the Holy Spirit had moved into your heart, you're not saved this morning. When the Holy Spirit moves into your heart, you won't know it because things change, buddy. He starts rearranging stuff and you will never be the same again. You can try to deny it. You can stiffen your neck, harden your heart. You can pull against the reins of the master's hands. But I'm here to tell you right now, if you are truly saved, you will bow your knee. You will bow your knee to your Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. Because the Holy Spirit will contend with you and he will deal with you. So if you're an eklektos, you need to know that the Apostle Paul endured burdens for somebody like you. And he's encouraging young Timothy to do the same. Why? That they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Yes, young Timothy, I'm about to lose my head to Nero's empire because I preach about this Jesus who was the seed of David and who was raised from the dead. But I'm about to enter into eternal glory.
Hallelujah.
He was convinced, amen, that was going to be true. Now, one of the first things that I wanted you to note was in verse 21 of 2 Timothy. I'm sorry, not verse 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. One of the very first things that he tells him, he calls him his son. That's a different context today when they say it than it was then. It was a good thing back then. Now it's like kind of belittling a little bit. He says, now therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ. Not when you call your actual son your son. I'm talking about the way these gangsters talk. You know, come on, son, that kind of thing. Anyway, whatever. All right. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Now, what does that mean? That means that you're not going to be able to do it in your own strength.
Amen.
That means whenever you find yourself in the midst of trial and tribulation, whenever you find yourself in a circumstance where you have to endure affliction, if you're trying in your own willpower and you're trying in your own strength and you're trying to accomplish through your own wisdom and your own intellect, you are going to fail in your endurance. What you need to understand is that God never asked you to endure in your own strength. No. God had a beautiful plan in place, hallelujah, that he wants to introduce you to, that he wants to introduce me to, where he becomes the power source, where he is the victory, hallelujah, where he dispenses grace in the midst of your life. I mentioned it last week, or probably Wednesday night, because I just erased it on the board the other day, where I gave you the definition of grace again. A divine influence on the heart and its reflection in the life. What does that mean? Many times people think of grace just as, man, I really messed up, but God's grace is going to get me through. In other words, the forgiving power of God, and that is true. God's grace will never fail you if you truly do desire to be forgiven. But it's bigger than that. True grace describes power given by God to strengthen the believer in the midst of any circumstance that he finds himself. What is it that you need today as you wait on the promises of God? As you wait on God to minister to you, to bring to pass even things that are going to happen in this earth. That ain't all going to happen in this earth, by the way. You're not going to get every promise fulfilled on this earth. Amen. Sorry, Abraham didn't, and you won't either. But there's some stuff to look forward to in the next life. And the question that you have to ask yourself is, if you don't get what you wanted on this earth, are you still going to serve Him? Yeah. Are you still going to love Him? Are you still going to bow your knee to Him? And are you still going to patiently wait and endure and not get tangled up while you're here, hallelujah, as you wait on the promises of God? And so I want you to know that you can't do it in your own strength. You need the grace of God. Amen? Amen. So that's the first thing I want you to know. Timothy is exhorted to be strong in the grace that is found in Christ Jesus. And the word strong there literally is in dunamo. And I mean, this is how the word would be spelled if you in dunamo, if you were going to write it in an English word. And you know, we got a couple of English words here in do, and also this other Greek word is part of it, dunamis. Dunamis describes the power of God. It's where we get our word dynamite. The explosive power of God. It describes a supernatural power of God that is given to the believer. But to endue means to clothe somebody with something. See, when you were taken out of the world and put in Christ, you were clothed with Him. You were clothed with His righteousness, which gave you access to grace. Because, see, that's why He had to die on the cross for your sin. Because God can't have relationship with sin. And so, therefore, He gave His only begotten Son, the precious one, the obedient one, who never once failed, who gave His life in your place and died in your place, taking your sin. Listen to me. Some people don't like to hear the word sin, but we got to have to deal with sin. We got to have to understand that's the problem with the human heart. Amen. Sin stands in the way between man and God. But God is loving, He's kind, and He's merciful, and He made a way. He sent His Son to deal with the sin factor. Amen? He's asking you to believe in that. That's all He's asking from you. For you to recognize you have a sin problem, and for you to recognize that He has a sin solution. Amen. And for you to put your faith in His solution, and He'll take care of the rest. Amen? Amen? And whenever you do that, you become clothed upon with the righteousness of the Lord. You become clothed upon with the power of God. And now the power of God is working in you. See, the problem, though, that a lot of times is that we don't want to surrender. We don't want to bow our knee. We want to hold on to our own power. We want to hold on to our own wisdom. Hold on a second, Lord. I think I can figure this one out. You know, I may forget to get to it, but something that kept going on in my heart as I was writing this message is that there's so many times in our life that we hear that little small voice of the Lord. Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Have you ever heard the small
Amen.
Voice of the Lord?
Yes.
And you know it's the Lord because it isn't you, right? Yeah. And what I'm trying to tell you is that you know that it didn't come from your own heart.
Yeah.
You know what your heart looks like, right? Is it okay if I tell you that?
Yeah.
Your heart ain't right. Jeremiah said it, not mad. The Lord said it, not mad. Don't get mad at the preacher. Our hearts left to ourselves. Well, look, I wasn't planning on going here, but if you don't believe me, I'm just going to tell you what the Word of God says. Romans chapter 3 says, verse 10. Romans chapter 3, verse 10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understands. There is none that seeks after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that does good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. That means a tomb. That means the things that come out of people's mouths are full of the stench of death. With their tongues, they have used deceit. The poison of asps or a snake is under their lips. In other words, they use their mouth to bring forth curses instead of healing to people. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. The way of peace they have not known. You get the point now. That the Word of God says, now listen, you got to understand something. Man left to himself, this is what he looks like. When God intervenes, He will begin to change some things. But don't think just because you've been saved for 5 or 6 years that your heart is just all pure as gold. Come on. And that you don't ever mess up, or that there's some things in there that aren't right. The point that I was trying to make with that is this. the Lord just keeps putting on my heart, I speak to my people. Speak to you, son.
Yeah.
And there's many times that we hear that still small voice, and we're like, oh, well, you know, it's not that big of a deal. And we kind of push it off to the side. Invariably, each and every one of us in this room this morning is probably still going to do that sometime even today.
Yeah.
I just want you to know that there's danger connected to that.
Yes,
there's danger connected to that. That the more we reject that counsel, the more we reject that voice, the harder our hearts can become towards those situations. You just need to know that the preacher told you. Amen. The preacher told himself. We need to be aware of that in this particular situation. All right. So young Timothy's being told that you've been clothed upon by the power of God. And so the main point that I was making with all that is that it's God's power that's got to get you through, and it's God's wisdom that's got to get you through.
Amen.
You're not going to get through this thing in the midst of enduring the affliction if you're operating in your own wisdom.
Amen.
In your own understanding.
Yes.
In your own knowledge. You know, not only is our heart messed up, but our heart in the inner man, biblical terminology, is connected to the soul and the mind. All this stuff is interconnected. And you know how messed up our minds are? I mean, we've been enculturated, and I mean, I don't need to put on the show for you, but we've been enculturated by a society that has told us things are supposed to be a certain way, and the Word of God is completely contrary to what society is teaching us. The music we listen to preaches a opposite gospel, not gospel, an opposite lie to the gospel that we read. Everything that the Bible says we should do, the music industry says we shouldn't do. Oh, now you're picking on my music. That's between you and Jesus. I'm telling you right now, it's another spirit of another kind.
Yeah.
I go preach at the school over there. I start picking on secular music, and I can see one of the pastors back there like wiggling and squirming. And dude, it's not my fault that you made a choice to convince yourself that secular music's okay. No, it's not. I don't care if it's just a little love song that you... I said this the last time. I can't help myself. Y'all think I just do it here? I can't help myself. I said it the last time. I said, and for you that think that secular music's okay, because it's just a little love song that dude wrote to his wife. No, Lionel Richie, come to find out, all them love songs he was supposed to be writing to his wife wasn't his wife after all. It's another spirit of another kind that's moving through their hearts, and it's not of the Lord. See, because you'll never convince the Lord that it's okay. You might convince your own mind and your own heart that it's okay, Lionel, to write that song to that other old girl, but you'll never convince the Lord, and the gospel will never allow you to say that that was okay. No, the reality of it is that it's not okay.
Amen.
It's not okay in the eyes of God.
Amen.
Amen? But yet the world out there is preaching another gospel to us. The Hollywood is preaching another gospel to us. Oh, what do you say, preacher? I can't. That's not what I'm trying to tell you. You do whatever you want to do, but you need to know that they're preaching lies to you.
Amen.
And they're trying to inundate you with a new system. That's why you let your children watch television when you're not paying attention. And before you know it, they're going to think that homosexuality is perfectly fine. They're going to think that abortion is perfectly fine. They're going to think that heterosexual, illicit sexual affair, whatever the case, is perfectly fine. When the reality of it is that you'll never get that from the gospel of Jesus Christ. They'll start them off at a young age. That's why they're saying these millennials, whatever that means, young people, they don't know who to vote for. Oh, we can't vote for you. I was talking to this guy at the YMCA. I can't with a good conscience vote for either one of them. I'm thinking to myself, dude, please, don't get me preaching up in this place because your heart's wicked too, acting like you ain't never done nothing wrong. The reality of it is that you need to come to the realization of what you stand for. You're cool with pulling a baby out of its mother's womb right before it's born and killing it? Okay, if that's you, then you got a candidate. You're cool with homosexual marriage in the middle? Well, if that's you, you got a candidate. You know who to vote for. Get your hiney up and go vote if that's what you believe. But if you're not cool with that, you got a candidate.
Yeah.
And don't sit here and say, well, you know what? And it wasn't that long ago I was telling y'all I don't even think that the presidential election is real. And I still don't know whether it's real. But I tell you one thing. I will be voting on that day. And I will cast a vote for a candidate. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I I do not like the other option even a little bit. And I'm telling you that we're being moved in a direction that's bringing it. And will it stop it in an election booth? I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is I'm not going to be able to complain as things go the wrong way when if I have not at least gotten up off my hiney and went and did my little part. And I watched a movie the other day, a Western, about when they first started letting people vote. Well, it wasn't just started letting people vote, but and they had two different parties, and these people went and they voted for Republicans, and everybody else was Democrats in the movie, and the way that they count, they showed the corruption. There's about 50 people that went cast a vote for a Republican candidate, and when it was all said and done, they showed you the poll, you know, the vote. It turned out there was two Republican votes, meaning it was corrupt. But the point was this. Them dope boys walked up in there in this movie, I'm just trying to make a point, with guns. And they said, no, we came to cast our vote today. And we're either going to cast our vote or we're going to die. And the point that I'm trying to make is that whether or not the whole election process really works or not, I don't know. I don't know why I went off on this. But I'm trying to tell you something. You got to figure out what you stand for. And you need to take a stand. Don't let what everybody else is telling you sway you and manipulate your mindset into believing that something is the way that it is, when the reality of it is that it's not that way at all. The media is trying to poison our minds and to make us think things a certain way. They twist the words of people, and I don't know about you, but I can sit here and watch it while they're twisting it. I can figure it out. That is not what that dude said. You just said he said that, and that's not what he said. If you can't tell the difference, then you got a problem. You need to learn. You need to pray for some intellect, some understanding. Because, yes, did he say it exactly the way he should have? No, he didn't. But it's not his fault. He can't articulate everything. Some people talk well. Some people don't.
Right.
Anyway, why did we get off on that? I don't know. You were clothed with power.
Amen.
You were clothed with power. God wants to give you wisdom. He wants to give you understanding.
Amen.
You're not going to be able to figure it out in your own strength as you navigate this journey called Christianity. Amen. Don't get entangled. Amen. God wants to empower you from your newfound position in Christ. And our wild and wicked hearts will reset our GPS and send us in a different direction that is off path, that the path that leads to the will of God. If we believe our own hearts and minds. Furthermore, the change in direction almost always comes when we're in the midst of a conflict or when obstacles get in the way. It's just like a regular GPS. You're driving down the road Sunday morning. You got your top off, you know, your little sunroof open or whatever the case. And everything is fine, man. The air's a little bit crisp. It's a real nice day, right? And all of a sudden, there's a big obstacle in the road. Some wreck happened. I can take a left right here. Well, guess what? When you take a left, what happens? Your GPS redirects. And it sends you in another direction. Same thing in life. You're clipping along, everything's fine, and all of a sudden your own head and your own heart start to tell you to go in a particular direction. And when you do, you reroute. Well, now you're not heading down the path anymore. You're not enduring even in the midst of the affliction. The affliction, the obstacle got in your way and caused you to change course, caused you to veer off and to go in another direction. We veer off. And it redirects. But listen, the word of God right here, he's talking about enduring hardness. And I want you to know that's one Greek word in the original language, and it's a verb. And I already said it once, but it describes the process of enduring hard times, to endure affliction, to suffer trouble. And the Apostle Paul can talk to us about that because the chains are clanking as he's writing. He's been entangled up, but for a different reason than what many people get tangled up for. I couldn't help but write in my notes. Some people in the audience would probably say, dude, why are you always talking about that? Why are you always talking about affliction? Why are you always talking about trial and tribulation? Why? Because the Bible always talks about it. Because living the Christian life on this fallen earth is like a salmon swimming upstream. There's nothing easy about it. You're completely contrary. You're an alien from a foreign land upon this earth. You understand that? This place is not your home. And everything about this fallen earth is contrary to you. And so the Word of God is filled with the fact that men and women of God have faced adversity whenever they truly decide to live their life for the Lord. So this is just a little reminder for the preacher and a reminder for you. The next time you're feeling down on yourself, guess what? You ain't the first one. Guess what? You're not the first one to suffer persecution. I'm not talking about the kind of persecution and affliction we bring on ourselves. Yeah. I'm not talking about the kind where we open up the wrong door, we go the wrong way, we change our GPS, and we kind of jack it all up. I'm talking about the fact that the earth is falling, bad things happen, and affliction occurs. But the reality of it is this, is that we're not the only ones. Amen?
Amen.
The reality of it is that everybody is experiencing. Yeah. Now, some is worse than others. Granted, I understand. I have felt some pain. It hurt really bad when my sister died. But God uses pain. He uses pain in the midst of our life. Sometimes we can't see it right at first. But if we'll hold on to, man, I tell you, one of the best scriptures, God causes all things to work together for good to those that love Him. Amen? And God knows how to do that. So that's why I always talk about this. But what I want you to know also is that Paul uses three examples that help us on this journey. In that passage of Scripture that we just read out of 2 Timothy, he uses the analogy of a soldier, the analogy of an athlete, and the analogy of a farmer. All three things have some things in common. First of all, they all have to stay focused on the goal. And there is hard work involved. And there are certain rules and laws that govern their decisions. What are you talking about? Well, I mean, rules and laws, at least of a farmer, seasons matter. When you till the ground, when you sow the seed, there's certain laws. And see, so when I'm talking to you at hard work, when I talk about hard work, you got to get out there and you got to till the ground. You got to sow the seed. You got to reap a harvest. I'm not talking about you working your way into the kingdom. I'm not talking about you working your way towards sanctification. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is endurance. I'm talking about steadfastness in the midst of affliction. Amen. Number one, the soldier. In the case of the soldier, Paul said that he doesn't allow himself to become entangled in civilian affairs. The word entangled means to become intertwined in such a way that you're hindered. All wrapped up, all tangled up. If you could just imagine, a kid playing with some yarn, and he comes in there and he's just all tangled up in the yarn. A soldier that's entangled can't fight. An athlete that's entangled can't compete. And a farmer that's entangled, he can't till, he can't sow, he can't reap a harvest. And a Christian that's entangled cannot endure the journey. You get entangled in civilian affairs. The word civilian affairs is actually just one word in the Greek. It describes pursuits. Some of the pursuits that we engage in are straight up wrong, right? I mean, the fact of the matter is we can pursue things on this earth that are completely contrary to the Word of God. But there's other pursuits that in and of themselves, they aren't wrong. Meaning, we attain education. We work towards education. We work towards a career choice. Many people have a great desire to have a family. Amen. All of these things are noble things to move towards. But can I tell you something? When you allow yourself to become entangled in the pursuit of those things, and because of that, you begin to slip backwards away from God, now you have a problem. Now you have a problem because we're not thinking about the fact of how will this pursuit affect my tomorrow with God. This goes back to you can't figure it out in your own intellect. You can't get it accomplished in your own strength. You have to hear the voice of God. You have to allow His voice to lead and guide you along the way as you're traveling this GPS pathway that He's bringing you towards the end, which is to hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." That's the soldier. He's got to fight the fight.
Yes,
he doesn't entangle himself. He doesn't get all tangled up in the pursuits of this life. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, not to get tangled up in the pursuits of this life. Help us, Lord, to always keep You on the forefront. Help us, Lord, to always remember that no matter what I endure today, You are my prize. You are my treasure. I desire to hold on to You if I have to let go of everything else.
Amen.
Lord, help us.
Yes.
Yes, Lord.
Number two is the athlete. He says, if a man strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned except he strive lawfully. So the whole phrase there, strive for masteries, all that whole phrase is this word in the Greek, athleo. It's not a noun for athlete, but it's the idea of athletics. It's the idea of competing. But the idea behind it is the rigid process that an athlete had to undergo in order to qualify in the original Greek games. It required diet, a specific type of nutrition. It required a specific skill level, and it required long-term competitive training. You know, that's what it means when it says right there that he must strive lawfully. It means he must play by the rules of engagement.
Right.
He must have entered in the way that you were supposed to. The point that I'm trying to make to you, a couple of points with this is, number one, we play by a different set of rules. I'm not talking about rules and regulations, once again, to live necessarily your life by, but at the same time, I'm talking about rules and regulations to live your life by. God doesn't give us boundaries to try. He gives us to try to make us miserable. God gives us boundaries to protect us. We don't play by the same rules that they play by. Who's they? The world. Those that are still over there in the first birth of Adam. We don't play by their rules. We don't go where they go. We don't listen to what they listen to. We don't put our eyes upon what they put their eyes on. And we don't talk the way they talk. Slow down, dude. I'm a preacher. You got to stop. I don't want to hear that. I don't talk that way.
Amen.
God, change me.
Yes.
I said, change me, Lord.
Yes, amen.
We play by a different set of rules. You can't expect to get the Stephanos, the victor's crown, if you're still playing by the same old rules that you used to play by. There's a certain the Word of God begins to regulate your life.
Amen.
As an athlete, who what you would do is you would strictly train, strenuously train, and whatever your sport was, you would repetitively go over it time and again. Whether if it was something like, if you were in the Olympics and you were doing something like judo, you would do the same throw 150, however many times you did it, to where it becomes muscle memory. What does that mean? It means whenever you're faced with that situation, you don't even think about it anymore, you just do it. When you train in the Word of God at that level, to where the Word of God becomes part of who you are, and you're navigating the circumstances of life, and you come upon the situation, guess what? Muscle memory kicks in, and you already know what's right versus what's wrong. All I had to do was hear the first sentence out of your mouth, and I know that ain't the Lord. It don't sound nothing like my Jesus. It doesn't sound anything like the word that I read. It doesn't sound anything like the spirit that lives
Amen.
On the inside
yes.
of me.
Amen.
And I'm not just talking about the way that old boy was talking in the Y. That was so easy to figure out. Goodness gracious alive. That was like easy stuff to figure out. I'm talking about even the motive, the heart of man, the way that people scheme in their minds to try to accomplish things. I'm thinking to myself, dude, that's not the Lord. That is not the Lord what you're talking about right there. Amen? And sometimes we deceive ourselves. We deceive ourselves into thinking, what's the Lord? No, if you're going to win the victor's crown, you're going to strive lawfully. You're going to play by the rules of engagement. The Word of God is the textbook that teaches you that. The Holy Spirit, through the Word of God, will reveal the truth to you. Amen? And you're going to have to train yourself in this Word. Don't blame the preacher. I'm just saying, whatever. I'm not even necessarily talking about me, but yeah, don't blame me. Don't blame the preacher. Don't blame your mama. Don't blame your daddy. Don't blame nobody but yourself. If you're a new Christian, that's different. You're just getting started in this race. Amen? And this is a lifelong process of learning the truth of Christianity. But if you really want to have the heart of God and the mind of God, if you really want to be able to operate through muscle memory and know how to respond in particular situations, you're going to have to put the Word of God in your heart.
Amen.
And you've got to give the Holy Spirit something to work with.
Right.
And I'm not just talking about, oh, I got to read 3 chapters a day because the preacher told me I had to read. No, man, that's a works-based system. You got to understand the Word of God. If you don't, but I don't like to read. Okay, well, then you need to pray. You need, do you know? Alarm, alert. Do you ever watch the news? Alert, breaking news. Yeah, breaking news. If you don't have a love for the Word of God, you better start praying. You better start praying and say, Lord, give me a hunger for the Word. No more excuses. Oh, I don't like to read. This is the Word of God, the living Word of life. God communicated with fallen man through this Word. If you don't love to read the Word, you need to pray.
Yeah.
I don't like the way you're talking to me, preacher. Well, okay. I'm sorry if I offended you. Really, I am. I don't want to offend you. But what I will tell you is I'm not sorry. I told you the truth.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
How do I know that? Because I was a mediocre Christian for 12 years and didn't love the Word of God. And barely made it through. I was still operating on muscle memory from the old man. Whenever the trials and the afflictions of life happened, I went back and reverted to his behavior. Oh, I got to get out of this stress. I got to find some kind of way to numb the pain. Got to find some kind of way to go back. No, you need Jesus, bro.
Amen.
You need Jesus. You need to learn how to hold on to him.
Yes.
Xanax ain't going to work. It's just going to lie to you for about 8 hours.
Yeah.
Another hit off a dude, he ain't going to do nothing but make you a little paranoid. And the stuff they come out with nowadays, I don't even know what that stuff does to you, bro. That stuff is like crazy, man.
Yes.
Why you even want to look like that? I don't know. But what I am trying to say is this. The old way of doing things ain't going to work. You got to put the Word of God in your heart.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. They got a lot of Christians that are incognito and they hide that stuff. They act like they hold on to the Lord, but the reality of it is when ain't nobody looking, they slipping a pill in their gullet. So we are the most medicated society in the world. I'm telling you that right now. The numbers are astronomical on prescription drugs that doctors freely write. People don't even know how to cope anymore. I was having a conversation with them. How is anybody going to know how to cope whenever everybody is on medicine almost? And not just people in the world, people in the church. Everybody's on medicine. Oh, here you go beating up people on medicine. I'm not beating nobody up. If you're on medicine right now because you're in the midst of a situation in your life and you didn't know how to hold on to Jesus, guess what? Listen to your doctor, but listen to the preacher. The medicine is not your final answer.
Amen.
Jesus
Amen.
Is your final answer.
Amen.
The medicine is a band-aid.
Yeah.
And sometimes the band-aid will cause a bigger problem because it doesn't allow you to reveal what's really going on
Amen.
Under there. What the Lord wants to do is he wants to get on the inside of your heart
yeah.
and he wants to bring healing
yes.
to your heart.
Yes.
He wants to reveal truth to you.
Yes.
And the more you medicate yourself and separate yourself from that reality, you will never be able to come to the place where God is truly desiring to set you free.
Amen.
You got to trust me
Amen.
On that. I wouldn't
yes.
come over here and
yes.
tell you a bunch of stuff just to make you
yes.
feel bad about yourself. I'm here to tell you that the Lord, amen, wants to set you
amen.
Free. You got we operate according to a different set of rules.
Yes.
We don't operate according to the rules of the world. The world, listen, I don't know why I keep talking about medicine. Psychology, probably because I don't like it. Psychology does not believe in God. And don't give me this garbage. Oh, well, the church down the road's got a Christian counselor who's got a degree in psychology and they use scripture. You can't mix the two.
Yeah.
You can amalgamate metal, meaning you can mix certain metals together and come up with an alloy, but you can't mix the theology with psychology.
Amen.
One is human wisdom. The other one is the wisdom of God. You want to know what the Word of God says about human wisdom? It says it's devilish and sensual,
yes.
meaning it's demonic.
Amen.
The one who created psychology, Sigmund Freud, I've already told you all this, he snorted cocaine and had an incestuous relationship with his daughter. The heart of human beings cannot help the other heart. Yeah, they might be able to help you, but they can't heal you.
Amen.
They have a different answer. They're painting it up, making it look good, but it's not a lie. It's keeping people from the truth. The science of psychology does not believe in God.
Amen.
They had to create their own way to help hurting people.
Yes.
God wants to be our source.
Yes.
God wants us to learn how to trust in Him when we endure affliction.
Amen.
And we keep medicating ourselves, however that looks like, whether the doctor writes my script or whether I go get it on my own off the street. That's what a lot of people do, man. They'll just, they go, I got a script from the doctor. Yeah, but you ain't telling nobody that when you run out, you go buy stuff off the street from old boy or old girl that you know. That's sin.
Yes.
It's called sin. Hello? It's against the law, and you're not supposed to do it.
Amen.
That's right. So anyway, that's another story. Don't get entangled in the affairs of this life. Don't allow yourself to get tangled up with civilian affairs in the pursuit of what it is that you're doing. The athlete, amen, he strives, but we play by a different set of rules and regulations. Amen. We have a different set of rules and regulations. Lastly, the farmer. Chapter 2, verse 6. It says, the husbandman that labors must first be partaker of the fruits. So we're talking once again about a farmer. We're talking about the fact that he has to get out there and he has to do the work. He has to till the ground. He has to sow the seed. He has to be willing to reap the harvest. It's not really funny, but I was just thinking, another thing that medicine does is it'll kind of slow you down. Some of those medicines will really slow you down. And not just that, I can remember one distinct thing back when I was an 80s pothead. I can remember one very distinct thing. I didn't want to hit a lick, bro. I'm telling you right now, if there's one thing drugs will do to your life, it will rob your desire to go to work. And you find yourself sitting on the couch flipping through the channel. Don't tell me, I know, because ESPN just came out and MTV just came out. I was a high school dropout sitting on the couch high, flipping through the channel. Like, yeah, dude, this is cool. All day long, day after day, day after day. You couldn't get me to get up and do nothing, man, except seek another high. And guess what? The next scripture, the farmer, if he lives his life that way, he ain't going to eat.
Amen.
The Christian that won't endure in the midst of affliction, he's not good. You're not going to endure if you're over there living your life that way and not learning the Word of God. Proverbs chapter 24, verses 30 through 34. That's kind of why I laughed a little bit, because I was thinking about, I didn't really make that connection when I wrote the message, because I didn't know I was going to talk about medicine and stuff. But that's exactly what drugs did to me. It turned me into a slothful sluggard. And that's what this proverb talks about. See, this farmer needs to wake up. He has to till the land. He has to sow the seed. He has to prepare for harvest. And in a spiritual sense, our life is the same. When we begin to neglect the things of God in our lives and start a backward slide, things begin to fall apart. Proverbs 24, verses 30 through 34. I went by the field of the slothful. You know what slothful means? That was me on the couch flipping through the channel, watching ESPN, high on weed. And by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. He doesn't have the understanding of God. When the proverb talks about understanding, he's talking about the things of God. He has no understanding of the things of God. And lo, it was all grown over with thorns, and nettles had covered the face thereof. You know what a nettle is? You ever seen those kinds of weeds that grow and they're kind of prickly and they just kind of take over? Like if you leave a house alone in the woods in Louisiana, that thing will be just completely overgrown. Like you'd be walking through the woods and you'll run into a house because you didn't even see it, because it gets overgrown by these weeds that grow like this. Yeah. Stinging nettles. Is that what they call them? The stone wall thereof was broken down, and then I saw and considered it well. So he stopped, he viewed this situation, and he pondered it in his heart. I looked upon it and received instruction, yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as one that travels, and thy want as an armed man. So when we look at this overall, this slothful sluggard in his vineyard, what we see in a spiritual sense, if this was our walk with God, because there's always a spiritual connotation to it. And our walk with God as a slothful sluggard, the walls broke down, the thorns are overgrown, and the nettles are overgrown. One thing I know about thorns is whenever the Bible uses thorns, it's got a direct connection to something. Y'all know what it is?
Sin.
Thank you. It's a direct connection to sin. Why? The curse of the fall. Well, immediately when Adam fell into sin, what began to grow out the ground? Thorns and thistles are representative. That's why Jesus took a crown of thorns on his head. He bore the curse. Thorns are a representative of sin. When you begin to neglect the things of God in your life, guess what happens? Your little vineyard starts getting overrun with the thorns of sin. Nettles. What is a nettle? It's a weed. It's a form of a weed. What do we know about weeds out of the New Testament? In the parable of the sower, what happens? Some of the seed, the gospel, was sown amongst soil along with the weeds, the thorny weeds. And what ended up happening? They grew up together. And what happened? It choked them. It choked the good seed out and caused it to die. And what do you call it? The cares of the world. The thorny weeds represent the cares of the world. What is that? Civilian affairs. Getting entangled in the midst of civilian affairs. The slothful sluggard. Not only that, guess what also happened? His wall was broke down. Well, a wall in the Old Testament and ancient was used around ancient cities, and it was also used around farmland. Why? To provide protection. The wall provided protection in the city from the enemy coming in. The wall provided protection of the farmland from wild animals coming and eating everything. This is the thing. God, whenever you were born again, you are born again this morning, I hope. Amen. When you were born again, God put a hedge of protection around you. For those of you that can't see over there to my left, I'll write it over here so you can see also. And if you'll remember, that was one of the first messages I preached when we started the church too. What does that mean right there? It's called a battle round. That's where the word peculiar people out of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. You're a peculiar person. The word in the Greek there means about, around. What does it mean? God put a hedge around you. When you got saved, God put a hedge of protection around you. Just as that hedge of protection, like that stone wall, brought protection, amen, against that. God, when you got saved, God. But God is not going to continue to protect you nor me if we continue to live like the slothful sluggard. He will allow his hand of protection to be moved back for a period of time. Well, that's not very good, God. No, that's a loving God. That's a beautiful, merciful God that loves you more than he does to protect you in the midst of your sin and to allow you to continue on that way. No, he will allow the wall to be broken down. He will allow your stuff to be exposed to the outside in order for you to be able to get your heart right with God. Lord, help us.
Amen.
Amen. Help us not to be like the slothful sluggard. All right? And so we see these types, once again, of the soldier, the athlete, and the farmer. Now, we talked about in the farmer about the nettles and the thorns and the broken wall, but you know the part that got me the most was his hands were folded. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands, and suddenly you're part. It's almost like he's able to rest in the midst of all this. In the midst of all this, he's able to rest. And he acts like, hey, there's not a problem. And all you got to do, dude, is just roll off to the side and go look out the window. Well, you can't because there's nettles that are covering your window. It's real dark in there. Everything's overgrown. The walls broke down. It's a problem. And that's what we do. Our spiritual life's crumbling. Come on.
Yes.
You ever been there? I have.
Yes.
Our spiritual life's crumbling. We just over there with our hands folded, acting like everything's okay, taking a nap. No, this isn't time for a peaceful nap. This is time to wake up. Don't slumber. Don't be drunk. Get sober real quick. Wake up and realize everything's not okay. Things are being broken down and overgrown, and it's time, hallelujah, to wake up and to begin to move in the right direction. Don't get so caught up in your affliction. Don't get caught so caught up in the midst of your misery that you lose sight of the prize. Amen. That you remember that there's an eternal weight of glory for you to be a partaker of, that Jesus purchased at a high price so that you could rule and reign with him for all eternity. Jesus loves you, and he wants to see you on that day. He wants to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into your rest. Not, well done, unfaithful sluggard. You did real well at napping. You did a good job at folding your hands. I'm preaching to myself this morning, by the way, in case y'all didn't know that. All right. Enduring hardships while we wait on the promises of God can be a very hard thing to do for all of us sometimes. There's always New Testament or Old Testament examples of these New Testament truths that we preach. There were three examples. Two examples out of Hebrews 11, Abraham and Moses. And one example, what in Hebrews 11? It was Lot. And what I need you to know is that everybody was enduring affliction. Everybody was enduring affliction, but Abraham and Moses made decisions that separated themselves. Lot, on the other hand, made a different kind of decision. We'll talk to you a little bit about that tonight whenever we come back together and the decisions that people make, amen, and how it can affect our lives.